Welcome, everybody. I'm Ken Burns. I've spent more than 40 years making documentary films that tell America's stories for PBS, and it really is a high point of my professional life to introduce the second annual Better Angels Student History Documentary Film Festival. What drew me to this kind of filmmaking, and what I hope inspires you today, is the fact that this is as close to time travel as any of us can get. For my entire professional life, I've been traveling back in time through moving images, voices, photographs, and sound that bring the past back to life and put us right in the middle of it. That's pretty cool. The films you're about to see are wonderful, and they were all made by middle and high school students just like you. After you watch, the students are here to tell you why they made them and how they made them, with a little help from our moderator, Mike Mashon, whose regular job at the Library of Congress is to keep miles and miles of historic moving image footage from all across our country safe, sound, and well organized. You know, the great American writer Mark Twain is supposed to have said, "History doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes." So now it's time for you all to go into the time machine and visit the past. I have a feeling you'll see some of what's going on in our world today when you get there. So congratulations to the winning student filmmakers, because the history you bring us through these films make it possible for us to understand ourselves better right now, and maybe even to avoid some of the mistakes of the past as we navigate our future. Enjoy.
Penicillin, breaking bacterial barriers. In September of 1928, the accidental discovery of penicillium mold broke barriers and led to crucial medical and scientific discoveries. With the purification of penicillium mold into penicillin, bacterial infections became treatable. The cooperation of scientists, governments, and manufacturers led to the mass production of penicillin. This supply was used to aid World War II Allied soldiers. Penicillin paved the way for newer antibiotics, which, along with penicillin, are still used to treat otherwise deadly diseases. Before the discovery of penicillin, serious illness and death from bacterial infections were common. As of 1900, the top causes of death were pneumonia, influenza, tuberculosis, and enteritis. However, after penicillin was produced, leading causes of death drastically shifted to heart disease, cancer, and stroke. The early 1900s were an exciting time in the medical world. The smallpox vaccine and other medical discoveries helped change the course of medicine. Before World War I, the sterilization of medical instruments was not practiced. Therefore, infections spread during surgery. During World War I, antiseptics were used to sterilize instruments, but were also applied directly to wounds. Working in a war hospital in France, British doctors, Sir Almroth Wright and Alexander Fleming, realized cleaning wounds and medical equipment prevented infection. However, they were skeptical of using chemical antiseptics in wounds because they found antiseptics also killed germ-fighting white blood cells. Many soldiers in World War I died of infection because bits of cloth and shrapnel were buried in wounds where antiseptics could not reach. Dr. Fleming decided to find a natural germ killer to work with the body to defeat infection. In September of 1928, Scottish bacteriologist Alexander Fleming left a petri dish full of staphylococcal bacteria uncovered when he went on vacation. This oversight was not unusual, as many colleagues stated he was a messy person. Upon returning, the petri dish had grown mold that microscopically drifted through a window. Observing the dish, he saw bacteria around the mold had disappeared. Immediately, he realized the importance of his discovery. Alexander Fleming identified the mold as a strain of penicillium. Fleming tested ways to purify the penicillium for 6 months. Breaking the barrier of purifying the unstable compound was beyond his abilities. He published his findings in a paper in 1929. He then sent the penicillium to skilled chemists. However, none were able to purify the unstable mold so it could become a life-saving medication. In 1938, Oxford chemists Howard Florey and Ernst Chain came across Fleming's paper. Searching for an antibacterial substance to test, they decided to try to purify penicillium into penicillin. By 1940, Chain was able to partially purify penicillium using lyophilization, a form of freeze-drying. In July 1940, Florey and Chain injected deadly bacteria into 50 mice. To 25, they gave penicillin, and to the rest, they gave no treatment. Every 3 hours for 2 days, the treated mice were injected with penicillin. All but one of the treated mice survived. The ones left untreated died. This broke barriers, showing that partially purified penicillin was 1,000 times more effective at killing bacteria than the original mold and could be successfully used as a life-saving medicine. After successful tests with human subjects, Florey and Chain wanted penicillin produced. They went to potential manufacturers in Great Britain, but because the country was in the midst of fighting World War II, the manufacturers did not have the resources to produce penicillin. During the Battle of Britain, Florey and Chain were worried about airstrikes. They lined the inside of their clothes with penicillium, so if their lab was destroyed, they could work on penicillin again. In June 1941, Florey took some penicillium and left for the United States, to find labs to mass-produce penicillin. America, not yet in the war, had resources to manufacture it. A lab in Peoria, Illinois, was willing to produce penicillin. The output was 20 times more powerful than the production at Oxford due to using a new medium in which to grow the mold cultures, corn steep liquor. This first step broke barriers and led to the mass production of penicillin. Florey convinced several labs across the United States and Canada to develop penicillin. The barriers to mass production by these labs were summarized by American factory manager John L. Smith. The mold is as temperamental as an opera singer. The yields are low. The isolation is difficult. The extraction is murder. The purification invites disaster, and the assay is unsatisfactory. Two new developments helped American labs overcome these barriers. The first was deep tank fermentation, which grew greater amounts of penicillium than previous methods. The second was finding a new strain of penicillium, producing 6 times more penicillin than Fleming's strain. Penicillin was mass-produced in the United States and began saving lives in World War II. After years of work, the barriers to taking penicillin from a mold to a life-saving medication were broken. When Japan attacked Pearl Harbor and the United States joined the war, the need for mass-produced penicillin grew exponentially. Penicillin was not available to the public because it was needed in the war effort to save the lives of Allied soldiers. In the midst of fighting in World War II, the British government was concerned that the secret of penicillin would fall into the hands of the Axis powers. Alexander Fleming had sent some penicillium to a German scientist before the war started, but the scientist was unable to grow the strain. The United States was the largest producer of penicillin, but not the only one. Although under Nazi occupation, France and the Netherlands started secret work on developing penicillin. In 1942, Nazis demanded a strain of penicillium from Dutch scientists, who handed over a strain that did not produce penicillin, therefore thwarting the Nazis' plans. The Dutch secretly continued their work on penicillin under the codename Bacchanal. German scientists were unable to overcome the barriers to purifying penicillium until October of 1944. By that time, the Nazis were incapable of mass production of penicillin due to Allied air raids over Germany. As of June 6, 1944, mass quantities of penicillin were needed to heal the wounds of Allied soldiers. According to makers of modern science, 95% of soldiers injected with penicillin recovered from their wounds. At the D-Day landings alone, 150,000 Allied soldiers were treated with penicillin. British Field Marshal Bernard Montgomery stated, "The healing of war wounds has been revolutionized by the use of penicillin. Many men who in the last war would have been permanent invalids were fit and ready to go back to the line within a month of being wounded." In December 1945, Alexander Fleming, Ernst Chain, and Howard Florey shared the Nobel Prize in Medicine for for their contributions in creating a medication that saved millions of soldiers and civilians' lives. Commenting on the significance of their accomplishment, Professor Hugo Theorel remarked, "This achievement called for years of labor, unerring instinct, profound and wide knowledge, teamwork, and some luck. Your penicillin was made available to mankind during the biggest of wars, but it is unable to serve anything but peaceful purposes. It cannot kill a mouse, though it can heal a man." Alexander Fleming in his Nobel Prize speech stated, "We all know that chance, fortune, fate, or destiny, call it what you will, has played a considerable part in many of the great discoveries in science. This is especially true of the biological sciences, for there we are dealing with living mechanisms about which there are enormous gaps in our knowledge." Since its fateful discovery, penicillin broke barriers and led to crucial medical and scientific discoveries. Because of the cooperation of researchers, government agencies, and manufacturers, the Allied powers mass-produced penicillin. With that production, penicillin broke the barriers of war, saving countless lives. After its success in World War II, it became widely available. It is estimated that penicillin has saved between 80 and 200 million lives. Penicillin contributed to a life expectancy increase from 47 to 78 years of age. The unprecedented collaboration necessary to produce penicillin stands as an example for researchers today, as they work to develop treatments for current diseases.
When looking back on our history, we often remember the firsts. Yet in our recollection, many are forgotten, with events that are simply lost in the history books. One of these men served as a pioneering activist and ultimately changed our world for the better. This is the story of Harvey Wiley, the man who changed America, one bite at a time. This story begins in the 1870s, a time where the Industrial Revolution gave way to hundreds of new technologies. Visionaries and scientists were constantly developing new inventions, and the world itself was changing rapidly. One of these great pioneers was Dr. Harvey Washington Wiley. After serving in the Civil War, he would go on to earn a doctorate in chemistry at Hanover College. In 1882, he was appointed chief chemist of the USDA's Division of Chemistry, serving as the leading chemist in the nation. One day, Wiley would make a shocking discovery. While testing sugar samples, he found that what he was testing wasn't actually sugar. It had been adulterated with borax, a chemical that he had deemed as a mild poison just 2 months earlier. Adulteration is the action of making something poorer in quality by the addition of another substance. By the 1880s, 77% of food products and 93% of the medicinal products on shelves were adulterated. Large companies at the time put their profits over the quality of their products, opting to choose cheap fillers and preservatives. Yellowed sugar was mixed with plaster in order to make it more appealing, while flour was bleached and dyed in order to keep it white for longer. Milk would be diluted with unsanitary water in order to fill more bottles, where drops of formaldehyde were added to others, causing nationwide scandals of embalmed milk. Other dairy products such as cheese and butter were simply made of excess fat scraped off the floors of meatpacking plants and repackaged. Moldy meats were ground up and made fresh sausage, while other scrap meats were filled with formaldehyde and mislabeled in order to make them appear fresher. And drug companies claimed to cure numerous ailments with just one product, but the medications people consumed were often useless or even poisonous. The public was completely blind to the poisons hiding in their foods, resulting in the deaths of over 15,000 Americans each year. The worst part? There was no food regulations on any of these products, meaning all of their practices were 100% legal. Wiley was appalled by the state of food safety in the US, and he knew that if he wanted to change it, he would have to do it himself. Wiley would begin his fight for food safety at a time where social change was at its peak in America. Just before the turn of the century, the Progressive Era hit the streets, the papers, and soon, the White House. Theodore Roosevelt took office in 1901, diverging from past presidents and siding with the people over businesses and corporations. That same year, Wiley would gain a valuable ally in his fight, a group of reporters known as the Muckrakers. These reporters pioneered the field of investigative journalism and exposed corrupt practices all over the United States. One of these reporters was Upton Sinclair, who exposed the horrors of the Chicago meatpacking industry in his book, The Jungle. In an excerpt from the book, it reads, "There would be meat that had tumbled out on the floor, in the dirt and sawdust, where the workers had tramped and spit uncounted billions of consumption germs. There would be meat stored in great piles in rooms, and the water from leaky roofs would drip over it, and thousands of rats would race about upon it. It was too dark in these storage places to see well, but a man could run his hand over these piles of meat and sweep off handfuls of the dried dung of rats." The publishing of his book sparked massive public outrage. Sinclair stated after its publishing, "I aimed for the public's heart, and by accident, I hit it in the stomach." Wiley would continue his fight, now with an uproar of public support, testifying before Congress on numerous occasions. For the first time in our nation's history, food safety became a concern for federal lawmakers. But as the days turned into weeks, and weeks into months, Congress still hadn't passed a single law regarding food safety. Wiley was met with fierce resistance from the same companies he had worked to expose.
The food industry had been organizing itself to fight regulation, probably at the point that Wiley starts these experiments in 1902. He had been advocating, and working with congressmen to try to get some kind of basic consumer protection regulations out there, if nothing else, labeling. And as he does these experiments, and as they catch national attention, which they did, they were front page news, there were songs and musical numbers about them. Everyone is suddenly realizing that there is a lot of bad stuff in their food. There's just a lot of bad stuff in their food. And so there's an immediate pushback, right, in which suddenly congressmen who are on the side of food business are getting offered more money, and the food industry actually organizes. They create a food manufacturers association and coalesce against making sure this doesn't happen. And they were phenomenally effective.
By 1902, Wiley was defeated. He had quickly been silenced by the power of large corporations. He knew he needed direct evidence, and soon he would devise a plan to do just that. A crazy experiment, the likes of which history had never seen before. He started by finding 12 volunteers for an experimental supper club. His plan? Add known adulterants and poisons into the same food they were eating and measure their body's long-term effects. In 1905, the brave volunteers sat down for their first meal. A dinner at the club would include applesauce, soup, turkey, canned string beans, sweet potatoes, mashed potatoes, chipped beef, bread and butter, coffee, rice pudding, and a little borax. Within a few short weeks, Wiley's supper club would soon be known as the Poison Squad. His volunteers would do hundreds, if not thousands, of tests, while his team of scientists began revealing the true horrors of these additives. His volunteers would experience dizziness, pains, indigestion, and vomiting. However, their sacrifices brought them lots of attention in the public eye, a notion that is reflected by Eric Schlosser in the PBS documentary series, The American Experience.
The Poison Squad and all the elaborate rituals around it, from the menu to the slogan on the wall, it was great public relations. It was flamboyant.
Before Wiley published a single result of his study, the Poison Squad had become a cultural phenomenon, and their exploits, real or imagined, legendary.
Wiley knew that now was his chance to act, aware that Congress was still under the grasp of corporations and lobbyists, so in a daring move, he turned his attention to the White House. Theodore Roosevelt was no stranger to food poisoning. During the Spanish-American War, thousands of his men died from rotting canned meat stored in their rations. Roosevelt knew that he couldn't wait for Congress to make up their mind, so in an unprecedented move, he demanded that they have a bill on his desk immediately. Wiley would debate on the bill through the night, until finally, on June 6, 1906, the Pure Food and Drug Act was signed into law by President Theodore Roosevelt. It would prevent the sale of adulterated foods and became the nation's first consumer protection legislation. Wiley would see the founding of the FDA, where he would become the nation's first food and drug commissioner. After 50 years of fighting for food purity and safety, Wiley's dream finally became a reality. He would continue to work for another 25 years until his passing on the 25th anniversary of the Pure Food and Drug Act's passage. Dr. Harvey Wiley's legacy continues to live on through long-lasting legislation, in every meal we eat, and every product we purchase. Wiley persevered through numerous barriers in order to improve the lives of the everyday American. And frankly, the food is better without all that borax.
May 1920. It was too early. Marion Conlon, pregnant with twins, was in a hospital in Brooklyn and her labor could not be stopped. She gave birth to two tiny, premature baby girls. One lived 20 minutes. The next, barely living, was so small it seemed impossible. Her parents received no sympathy from the obstetrician. "Don't rush to bury that one," he said brusquely, "because you will need to bury the other one too." He predicted that she would not live the day. "Aren't there machines for little babies that will help them?" the father, Woolsey Conlon, asked desperately. "Yes, but we don't have those here," the doctor said. Conlon remembered seeing a sideshow with premature infants in incubators at Atlantic City. That was hours away, but he remembered something else. The incubator doctor ran another sideshow closer to home. Woolsey Conlon, wrapping his 2-pound daughter in a towel, walked outside and hailed a taxi. "Coney Island," he directed. "Can you step on it, please?" All the world loves a baby, breaking the 2-pound barrier. The incubator doctor, Martin Arthur Cooney, was born Michael Kahn on December 29, 1869, in the Prussian town of Krodoschen. In 1888, just 18 or 19 years old, he immigrated to the United States. But one day, in 1896, Martin Cooney's life changed forever when he heard about a display of premature babies. Preemie sideshows, despite being a unique attraction, were not unheard of in Europe. The sideshow Cooney learned about was at the World's Fair, being shown by Pierre Boudin, a French physician. Cooney immediately realized the incubator's potential. He knew that it could save many lives. He was determined to find a way to save the babies. Though historians now believe that Cooney was not a medical doctor, he was interested in the care of preemies. He decided that he would do whatever he could to care for the babies. Without medical credentials, Cooney could not advocate for the babies from within the medical system. His only choice was to go to the sideshows. Don Raffel, author of The Strange Case of Dr. Cooney, How a Mysterious European Showman Saved Thousands of American Babies, explains.
In the United States, there were a number of barriers. So one is that hospitals didn't have tremendous resources then. The overall infant mortality rate was high, and there just wasn't a lot of concern for these very special babies, these tiny preemies.
Furthermore, the American eugenics movement a popular social movement which peaked in the 1920s and 30s, was very focused on the survival of the fittest. While the preemies were not direct targets of the movement, there was little concern for them. They were known as weaklings, even in medical literature. Cooney was frustrated that many people did not understand why caring for a premature baby was worth the effort and resources that were required to ensure their survival. He intended to break these barriers and to save lives. Beginning in 1903, Cooney ran two sideshow attractions at two of Coney Island's amusement parks, one in Luna Park and one at Dreamland. Over the years, his sideshows could be found across the United States, including at the 1933 Chicago World's Fair, the Pan American Exposition in Buffalo, New York, and a sideshow in Omaha, Nebraska. However, no matter where he was, his slogan was always written at the door of the show: "All the world loves a baby." Although sandwiched in the busy and crowded Midway, the infant incubator building was hard to miss. Just like any other sideshow, barkers attempted to lure in the crowds. "Come this way, ladies and gentlemen. See the tiniest bits of humanity. Maybe the future president is inside." The building's interior was calm and orderly, drastically different from the chaos and noise outside. Incubators stood against the walls. Nurses and doctors tended to tiny babies, born weeks premature and far below healthy birth weight. Everything was incredibly clean. Upon arrival, the baby was given a bath in cyanized water and mustard. Those that could swallow were given 2 drops of brandy. The baby was then rubbed with alcohol, swaddled, and given a pink or blue ribbon. The child was placed in an incubator kept at about 96 degrees Fahrenheit, depending on the patient.
There was a big scramble for clothing to fit me, that they had to buy doll's clothes. Nobody made clothing for tiny little babies. Even at about 5 pounds, I was still much smaller than the average baby.
In order to demonstrate scale for onlookers, Madame Emily Louise Recht, Cooney's head nurse, would slip a diamond ring around a baby's wrist. Although it is unlikely that Cooney had any medical education, the registered nurses who worked for him were well trained and incredibly skilled, including Annabelle May Segner of Lafayette, Indiana. Someone had recommended her to fill in as Cooney's head nurse while Madame Recht was in France for a short time. Segner would later marry Martin Cooney in 1903, and they would have one child, Hildegard, born prematurely herself. As an adult, Hildegard, too, would become one of the sideshow's nurses. Also helping Cooney was Dr. Julius Hess, a friend of Cooney's, now known as the father of American neonatology. Hess was critical to Cooney's success as he provided the medical credentials that were required by the medical community. Not every baby Cooney cared for would survive. He kept trying to break the 2-pound barrier. He would get an opportunity in 1918, when a baby girl weighing just under 2 pounds was delivered to Coney Island. There was no guarantee if she would live. She was named Lillian May Mandel. Upon her arrival, a nurse promised, "If she lives, I will buy her a dress." Fortunately, Lillian was able to receive that dress on her 18th birthday, becoming the first baby to break the 2-pound barrier thanks to Cooney's sideshow. When she graduated, she also received a golden wristwatch. Engraved on the back was, "From Uncle Martin." Beth Allen, born Beth Bernstein, weighed only 1 pound 10 ounces. Another baby, Anna Steinecke, supposedly weighed barely more than a pound. Achieving this required an entire team. May and Hildegard Cooney placed them, Louise Recht fed and cleaned them, Dr. Julius Hess provided medical assistance, and of course, behind them all, the man whose methods rescued them, Martin Cooney. He believed in them, cared for them, loved them. The incubators Cooney used were not a new invention. Similar incubators had been used previously in Europe. However, many of Cooney's methods for caring for preemies broke barriers and were life-saving. For instance, he insisted upon feeding only breast milk to the babies. He hired only the best nurses. He developed a way to feed the infants using a spoon through the nose. and monitored the temperature in the incubator depending on the infant's needs. This likely saved thousands of babies' lives. Cooney would not cease to run the sideshows until 1943, when incubators began to be widely used in hospitals. He did not only save the lives of the babies in the incubators of his sideshows, but by publicizing the remarkable qualities of the incubator, he caused the machine to be trusted by the medical community. As a result of his success saving premature babies, the incubator began to be commonly used by medical institutions. A common estimate puts the number of babies Cooney saved in his lifetime at 6,500 to 7,000 lives. Cooney's groundbreaking methods, along with the incubator, continue to impact the lives of premature infants who receive essential care in an incubator.
The whole thing is just amazing to me, and the older I get, the more appreciative I am of the opportunity that I was given to be here, to talk to you, and to live the wonderful life that I've had.
Before 1943, the survival of premature infants was grim. American hospitals did not have the technology or will to keep these babies alive, and premature infants were tragically left to die. Martin A. Cooney worked to save the lives of premature infants for over 40 years. Cooney worked tirelessly on an incubator, along with other specific techniques, to break the 2-pound barrier that was so important in the survival of premature babies. In order to be able to save the lives of the babies, Cooney did something almost unthinkable today. He put the babies and their incubators in sideshows. Cooney eventually broke the 2-pound barrier and managed to save the lives of thousands of premature babies.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mike Mashon, and I'm head of the Library of Congress Moving Image Section. Welcome to all of you students and teachers joining us, and it is my honor to moderate the discussion today. So a quick 101 for those of you watching who are new to National History Day. It's an annual competition in which over 500,000 middle and high school students around the U.S. and in American and international schools around the world compete every year. Students work individually or in groups to conduct history research projects centered around a theme. The 2020 theme was Breaking Barriers in History. Students select topics of their own choosing, present their research and analysis in one of 5 project categories: documentaries, exhibits, papers, performances, or websites. The Next Generation Angels Awards, made possible by the Better Angels Society, recognize the top winners in the junior and senior divisions of National History Day's individual documentary categories. It is these 6 winners and their films that we're here today to celebrate. I also want to note that you are encouraged to ask questions. There's a Q&A button on the right side of the Zoom screen. So we're going to begin with the 3 junior division winners whose films you have just seen: Allison Reed from Kansas, Rashid Shakib from Florida, and Caroline Bruton from Virginia. Congratulations to all of you. And let me start by asking you, Allison, why of the 5 project categories did you choose documentary?
I actually kind of chose it as a last resort. I didn't think I would enjoy it. I thought it would be really hard, but it's actually much easier than I thought it was going to be. I thought I would have to be in some fancy technical recording studio when in reality I was on the floor of my mother's closet with a microphone. I love it mostly because it's your own voice bringing your own writing along with the images and the music, and all of it put together is the most powerful way I think that you can communicate your project.
So, Rashid, said the same question to you. First, how did you choose your topic? And then why did you decide to do a documentary?
So I had always participated in film festivals, and this was my 3rd year of doing National History Day. So I'd always done documentaries beforehand, so I had experience in that category. And when choosing my topic, I tried to look for something that was outside of the box, and you know, something that people hadn't really been told, that story hadn't been told before. And it's as much as it's to my dismay, you can't just Google forgotten people to the history and find the thing that you're looking for. So I ended up stumbling across this book by Deborah Bloom, who I interviewed in my documentary. And I read the book and I was inspired. So I ended up taking that for my National History Day documentary.
And did you have some background? And you said you had done this before. Had you made documentaries before this?
Yes, I had done it all 3 years and I had done documentaries all 3 years.
Right. So Caroline, your film is about penicillin, which is a pretty broad topic. So can you kind of walk us through the process by which you kind of narrowed it down to the focus that you wound up with?
So to narrow it down, at first, I wanted to include everything, but you can't in a 10-minute documentary. So I did have to cut out a lot of stuff that I would have liked to include. So certain parts about the science of penicillin that I thought was really interesting. I wasn't sure if other people would think that, so I had to cut that out. And it felt like I was constantly cutting and rephrasing to make things shorter because my topic is so broad and I have to include so much.
So had you done like an outline beforehand to kind of help you focus, or I mean, how did that work?
Yes, I did have an outline of what order I wanted to say things in and what I wanted to include.
So Allison, I think it's safe to say that the story that you tell in your documentary is not widely known. So I'm curious, A, how you were inspired to do that topic in the first place. And then, you know, tell us a little more about the kind of resources that you used. And were there any moments when you were concerned that you might not have enough images or footage in order to illustrate your narrative?
Sure. So I originally found out about this project through my teachers, my National History Day teachers. They gave me the book that I mentioned in the documentary, The Strange Case of Dr. Cooney by Don Raffle, who I interviewed. I wasn't concerned that I wouldn't have enough pictures because I was able to find quite a few pictures, both from that book and online. But I did sometimes have a specific picture that I was looking for, but it wasn't available. So especially at the beginning, I have a lot of more generic pictures. And that's, I think, a good tip for someone who's trying to make a documentary like this. If you can't find the exact picture that you're looking for, try to find something more generic. Widen your search until you can find a picture that's appropriate.
So can you talk a little more specifically about some of the places where you went to look for some of those generic pictures?
Well, first of all, the internet is always the first place that pops into your head when you're going pictures. Where can I find pictures? But they can also be found in books. Some of mine were the property of one of the people I interviewed, Beth Allen, a former incubator baby herself.
And how did you find Ms. Allen, the incubator baby?
So she was mentioned in that book, and I interviewed Dawn Raffle first because her information was online, being an author. And I asked her if she would be willing. She also interviewed Beth Allen, so I asked her if she would be willing to provide me her email address, and she was very kind in doing that. Just goes to show that there's always a way to find that person who knows more about it than anyone else.
Very good point. Rishi, can you kind of walk us through your process? I mean, did you create an outline first? And, you know, since this is sort of an iterative process, how did your film change throughout the various stages of competition?
So as you start working through your research phase, one of the most important things is keeping your research organized. So I tend to make a bunch of different timelines and then highlight the events that I'm want to tell in my documentary. And then eventually from that, you can turn it into a script. And then as I went through the different levels of my competition, and before each level of competition, I was always looking through my documentary and seeing the things I wanted to change, comparing that to judges' critiques of what they wanted to see in my documentary, what other teachers, other viewers had seen in my documentary that they liked or didn't like. And then from there, you kind of refine it. So I have a distinct memory of going into my district competition and coming out with a medal and a whole page of things I hated in my documentary. So with that, you kind of have to be able to think that you're never really truly done with your project. You always have another little bit or a tweak or something that you can fix to make it better. And that's something that's very important to know if you're working on a documentary.
Were there things, I mean, Caroline mentioned this earlier, were there parts that you just hated to cut out? Were there things like that for you as well?
There was a really good portion of backstory to Harvey Wiley, and there was just a lot of, as painful as it was, you know, we try to tell these stories, like, which we could talk about for hours on end in a 10-minute time frame. So it's painful to cut something out. But then once you try to understand, a tip that works for me is try to say it in as little words as possible. And so if you tell the story in as few words as possible and as concisely as possible, you tend to understand subconsciously what are the most important events in your head. And then from there, you can work on that to your script.
So Caroline, I want to go back to the research phase of this. Like the others, you include a wide variety of resources in your documentary, from the Centers for Disease Control to medical journals. So I'm curious how you kept all of that organized.
So, well, as soon as I found a source that I liked, I would always write it down somewhere so that I could come back to it. And I also kept track of them by putting them in my bibliography so that I could come back to them later. And there are just so many of them. So at first it was kind of hard to keep track of it, but eventually I found out certain ways to, and putting them in my bibliography was definitely one of the better ways to organize them so that I could, they were always written down somewhere so that I could find them again.
So I'm curious what kind of software you use to assemble your documentary.
I used a program called WeVideo, and our school pays for it. And I think it's really nice and works very well.
Did you have any experience editing video before this?
Yes, I had made a documentary for an HD when I was in sixth grade. Okay. The year before.
So Allison, sort of the same question to you. What software did you use? Did you have experience doing this before?
I also used WeVideo, and our district also paid for it, which was very nice. It's always great when you don't have to worry about buying your own software. I did not have experience. This was my first go around at doing a documentary, which is one of the reasons I was surprised that I did well. I guess I would just say, if I can figure out how to do it, you can do it, because I am not a very tech savvy person. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm kind of curious. This really is sort of a question for all of you. There are going to be, I'm sure, students watching us who've never done this sort of thing before and may be concerned about their tech savviness. I mean, we've all watched at this point a lot of films and seen plenty of documentaries. So, you know, you have in your head how these things might be put together, but it's different actually sitting down and constructing that narrative. So, you know, was that a particularly time-consuming process of trying to figure out how to string images, words, everything else together into a coherent narrative? Rishi, how about you take that one?
Yeah, sure. So there's a process when you're filmmaking, it's called storyboarding. So that's when you have your scene and you're literally drawing out what you want the viewer to see. So I didn't fully storyboard, as if I didn't draw out every single picture that I wanted in my documentary, but over my scripts, I used captions or comments, or I highlighted certain portions and I was like, okay, during this line, I want to have this kind of photo showing or a picture of this person or of this place. And then from there, you can kind of organize what media you need to find and what media you need to look in archives for and what stuff you have already. And then from there, you can supplement, I like this better, I don't like this as much. And you know, you can kind of work it until you get a final product.
So we've had some really good questions come in through the chat, and I will also encourage people to continue submitting those as well. But here's one that came in. Where can students find royalty-free images, video, and music to use in projects? Anybody want to take that one?
I can take that since I've had a little bit of experience with copyright. So a good place for music is the website called YouTube Audio Library. I'm sure my film teacher at home is just screaming with joy right now that I mentioned it. But yeah, YouTube Audio Library has a great deal of royalty-free audio. And as far as royalty-free video, we are using it for educational purposes. So you don't really have to be worrying about the whole copyright. It falls under fair use. So videos and photos are a little bit more lenient on, though I would encourage all of you to look at archives and publicly domain available footage.
I'm also curious, you all faced challenges completing these projects during a global pandemic. Students who are watching us today are facing those very same challenges. Do you have any tips to provide them? Caroline? Go ahead, Allison, sorry.
I was gonna say, I think the most important thing when you're facing this is, first of all, try and keep in contact with your teacher. If you can't Zoom or Google Meet, try and email them. Just try and keep as much contact with your teacher as you can, because they will really help you a lot with advice, with comments, with critiques of your film. And secondly, it takes a lot of hard work on your own. It's one thing to do the hard work after school when your teacher is telling you to, but it's another thing to go home and spend 3 hours working on your documentary by yourself. It takes a lot of willpower to make yourself do it every day, but if you really enjoy the topic, you will really want to work hard on it.
And I think that that's an important point to make. I'd like for each of you to expand on this a little bit, and I'll start with you, Caroline. The importance of finding a topic that interests you in some ways, because it would certainly seem that if it's work, it's going to feel like work.
So it's definitely important to find a topic that interests you. Otherwise, you won't have any fun doing it. And picking something that you enjoy learning about. So if you like science, maybe do one on the history of science. Or if you're interested in a certain era, do that era, because if it's not something you enjoy, you're not going to want to work hard on it. And it's just not going to be, you're not going to get as much out of it if you don't enjoy doing it.
Rishi, how about you?
I feel like there's a certain amount of leniency that you have with history. And because history is all of human experience, and there's bound to be something crazy interesting that happened that you just don't know about yet. So if you're looking for something interesting, like if you're into, you know, I would look at big wars or big events, because espionage and spying during those times is always really interesting. And but specifically, if you know, like if you can look at something that interests you, like you know that you like action movies, or you like science, as Caroline mentioned, or if you have these broader topics, you can go to your history teacher, who probably knows a lot more context to these events, and isolate out a larger event, let's say the Cold War. And then from there, you can kind of narrow it down or pick something that really interests you within that topic, and then build a documentary or other project off of that.
So I have another question that came in from the chat. How do you think these events that were presented in your documentaries have affected our lives in the 21st century? Allison, I'll let you start us off with that.
Oh, okay. So I think that Martin Cooney's use of the incubator, he was using it when no one else in America was. I think that because he saved so many thousands of babies, that proved to the hospitals that the incubator worked, that it's not some pseudoscientific nonsense. It actually does save lives. And I think one of the most interesting things is that when Martin Cooney retired, It was when the incubators started to go into hospitals. He retired because the incubators were now in hospitals and his mission had been accomplished. Babies were being saved. And I think just the incubator is now used to save thousands and thousands of babies. And a lot of the responses I get are, my niece was an incubator baby. My son was an incubator baby. And just the effect that that's had on people, not only that Martin Cooney saved, but also that the incubator has saved, is remarkable.
Caroline, how about you?
Well, with antibiotics, they're still used today and they've saved millions of lives. And also right now with a search for a vaccination for COVID-19, it's important because with penicillin, they did things that they hadn't really done before. Like usually research companies and institutions weren't willing to share their research. They kept it to themselves for profit, but with penicillin, they started sharing it. And that's what's happening in a way right now. It's really cool to look and be like, oh, this happened with penicillin and I know about this now.
And Rishi?
So I think that all of us did something that's scientifically related. So I think it's important that you do also, you know, going back to advice for a future filmmaker, is that you have to come back home and connect with your viewer some way. You know, Caroline did it with penicillin. You know, I tried to do it with food safety, as since we all have to eat at some point. So there's just a lot of, the more you can connect to your viewer and your audience, the more effectual your documentary will be.
I'm also curious too about the connections that you made to your documentary, not just the fact that you're filmmakers, but did the working on the documentary affect you, and the topics that you chose, affect you personally in some way?
I think that I've been a lot more conscious about what I'm eating, first off. Second of all, I think that it does show me that a lot of really important stuff that we take for granted is completely missing or has a completely interesting backstory that a lot of us overlook. So I think to dig deeper and find and be grateful for the privileges that we have in a 21st century society.
Allison, how about you?
I agree with what Rishi said about the privileges of living in a 21st century society and about the background of, especially when it comes to science, everything being more interesting than you think it is. I think this project really made me reflect on how beautiful these little babies are, like their lives, they would grow up to be, like Beth Allen said, someone who is grateful for their life, someone who has family and friends and loves others and does good in the world. And I think that's just the most beautiful part about it to me.
Caroline?
So before I started researching penicillin, I was just like, oh, it's just another medicine. But now I know how many lives it's saved and how important it is. And I'm much more grateful for new medical and scientific discoveries that save lives.
So another question from the chat. If you had a chance to add something to your documentaries right now, what would it be?
20 more minutes.
That has got to be a really difficult part of doing these documentaries, a challenging part, let's just say, is trying to fit that all in 10 minutes. Yeah, you guys had a lot of information in those 10 minutes.
I think that if I could add something, it would be, like I mentioned, I did an interview with Beth Allen, who's a former incubator baby, and the quotes and the audio I used of her in the film were not my own. And I would like to include some of what she said about what her family's reaction was like to her being an incubator baby, what it was like to for her cousins to be able to come and see her in the sideshow. A lot of that was interesting, and that was too bad. I wasn't able to fit it in 10 minutes.
So Caroline, I'm sorry. I think you were about to say something.
I would just say that I would probably, if I had more time, I would include more about penicillin's development in other countries, because I found that so interesting but I just didn't have enough time.
Right. So as we near the end of our time together, just ask you to reflect and to, for the students who are watching, what advice would you give them to, you know, to make this into something fun and interesting that would encourage them to make a documentary? Allison?
First of all, it's not as hard as you think it's going to be. There are hard parts and it is difficult to learn how to do, but once you get the hang of it, once you practice at it, you can make a documentary about anything you want. It's a wonderful medium, for especially for History Day. And my second piece of advice is find a topic that makes it fun, not a chore. If it's a chore, it's just going to be another school project that you put off and put off. And that's what I did last year. And I think I enjoyed History Day this much more this year because I really loved the topic. I wanted to learn about it. I wanted to talk about it for hours and hours. So I think that's the most important part. Find something that you love and share it with the world.
Rishi?
Definitely to pick something that interests you and also tell a story that not many people know of, because I'm sure that, and I said this yesterday as well, my contestants are sure that every time you go to any level of competition, you see roughly 10 or 15 projects on the same few topics. So definitely, if you're going to say something people already know, dig deeper and go tell it in a way that not many people know, or pick a topic that most people don't know of and end up teaching them something a little bit more about the world around them.
Great. Caroline?
Like Allison said, it's very important to pick a topic that you're interested in. And I always think it's fun to look at it in a different way and to try to tell it in a way that you haven't heard it before, because that just makes it much more fun for me, at least.
Great. Well, look, Allison, Rishi, Caroline, congratulations again. And thanks so much for sharing your insights today. So we're going to be taking a 5-minute break, and we'll be back with the senior division winning filmmakers and their documentary. So take a break and stay tuned. We'll be right back. Hi, everyone, and welcome back. I'm Mike Mashon, head of the Library of Congress Moving Image Section. And now we're going to watch the winners of the Next Generation Angels Award in the National History Day Senior Individual Documentary category, followed by a question and answer session with the filmmakers.
I can see him today. His eyes were blazing, his face got red. And he said, "Stand on your feet, black boy. You can't sit down here." So I decided, and I was only about 8 years old, that I was going to stand against that kind of thing the rest of my life.
In the late 1950s, job discrimination was one of the most significant barriers to economic prosperity. This fostered the poverty that fell upon black people across the country. Black people were only able to find work in fields that required menial labor, and they were rarely ever hired into jobs that required any expertise. In attempts to combat job discrimination, a Philadelphia minister named Leon Sullivan dedicated his life to creating opportunities for black people to find promising work positions and obtain economic stability. Leon Sullivan dented the barrier of discrimination in employment in Philadelphia through the Selective Patronage Campaign, which gave black people the opportunity to be hired into quality job positions. This led to the Opportunities Industrialization Center, which provided people the training required to maintain these jobs, and Progress Plaza, which hosted black-owned and operated businesses. In the long term, this resulted in the continued training services of the OIC and the establishment of new businesses in Progress Plaza. The 1950s are considered a time of prosperity in the United States. After a victory in World War II, the economy was booming and most people felt like they were living the true American dream. But with the success of some came the struggle for others. The late 1950s also marked the beginning of a social and political movement for African Americans to receive the same rights as their white counterparts. In 1955, Martin Luther King Jr. assisted the Montgomery Improvement Association in organizing African Americans to boycott against segregated Montgomery buses. Then, in the beginning of 1960, college students launched a series of protests known as the Southern Sit-ins, because black people were not allowed service at whites-only lunch counters in North Carolina. These events inspired many people to take part in the civil rights movement and proved that demands for racial equality can be met when there is a unified group of people working together for a common goal. Inspired by these events, Leon Sullivan began his own movement to tackle discrimination in Philadelphia. At the end of the 1950s, the number of black people in Philadelphia surpassed 300,000, as a result of the influx of African Americans who migrated north during World War I and World War II, due to the attraction of northern jobs and industrial enterprises. When black people migrated to Philadelphia, they could settle into limited neighborhoods due to redlining policies and racial violence. One neighborhood that had a particularly high concentration of black people was North Philadelphia. However, as more black people were forced to move into North Philadelphia, more white people fled. Soon enough, North Philadelphia was a predominantly black neighborhood that suffered from urban decay, ghettoization, and neglect by city officials. Furthermore, during the late 1950s, black Philadelphians made up 43% of the unemployed population in Philadelphia. Not only were black people less likely to find employment, but they were also less likely to find employment in quality, well-paying jobs. This neighborhood segregation and inequality in the workplace paved the way for the development of a primarily black lower class in Philadelphia.
The city in the 1950s is rapidly turning to be one of the most segregated cities in the country. That segregation isn't accidental. That was built into a lot of policy decisions and a lot of legal restrictions and a lot of resistance.
The desire to help black people break the barriers that caused this forced poverty would become the driving factors for Leon Sullivan's projects in the future. Leon Sullivan was born in West Virginia in 1922, where he was first exposed to racial discrimination. When he was just 18 years old, he became a Baptist minister and moved to New York to serve under Reverend Adam Clayton Power Jr. Then in 1950, he came to Philadelphia to become the minister of Zion Baptist Church. It was there where he first discovered the poverty-stricken neighborhoods that encompass North Philadelphia. he realized that the only way to help people get out of poverty was to help people find jobs. In attempts to break the barrier of job discrimination, Leon Sullivan realized that he needed to target companies economically and use the economic power of the Black community to pressure prejudiced companies into hiring Black workers into more visible and highly paid job positions. To carry out this plan, Leon Sullivan enlisted the help of 400 additional Philadelphia-based ministers who urged Black people to stop buying from places where they could not work, in a boycott that became known as the Selective Patronage Campaign. The 400, or general gathering, would arrange a meeting with the top executive from a company. From there, a deadline would be given for the company to hire a certain number of Black job seekers in the desired positions. If the requests were not met in the allotted time, ministers would go to their pulpits the next Sunday morning and announce a selective patronage against the company. The first company targeted was the Tasty Baking Company. The ministers proposed that the company hire Black people to fill the roles of salesman drivers, office workers, and production line workers. Tasty Baking refused to meet these demands, and in response, Black Philadelphians immediately stopped purchasing Tasty Cakes.
They were not hiring Black drivers. They were not hiring our men and women to work in places other than civil service. So if we can't work there, we shouldn't be shopping there. I remember Leon telling us, don't eat Tasty Cake until you hear it from the pulpit.
After 3 months, Tasty Baking could no longer stand to lose the business that Black people gave them, and they eventually hired 2 Black women to the clerical staff and hired several Black driver salesmen. After the success of the Tasty Baking campaign, Leon Sullivan and the 400 ministers launched an additional 28 campaigns against other prejudiced companies in the area. Once Black people obtained quality jobs, the next step was providing them with job training so that they could keep these jobs. Numerous companies refused to hire Black workers because they claimed that they did not have the skills needed to perform their jobs properly. This ushered Leon Sullivan to launch his most triumphant program, the Opportunities Industrialization Center, or OIC. Mr. Sullivan explained that OIC is a program of self-help and self-motivation to provide practical training which prepares persons for a variety of occupations. The program first began in 1964 in an abandoned jailhouse in North Philadelphia. Soon enough, the OIC began educating students in a variety of fields. On the opening day of the OIC, on January 26, 1964, more than 8,000 people showed up in hopes of receiving training. The OIC began to grow quickly, with several new training centers opening across the city and in the areas that surrounded Philadelphia. After 6 months of training, 80% of the students at OIC were able to get well-paying jobs and continue to advance in high positions within their fields. The added job training that became available assisted Black people in obtaining better jobs and continued the fight against the barrier of job discrimination. Sullivan's next proposal to help break the barrier of job discrimination was through Progress Plaza. The goal of Progress Plaza was to help African American business owners succeed by giving them a prominent location to place their businesses and create new jobs. Progress Plaza became the first shopping center in the United States to be developed, owned, and managed entirely by African Americans. To fund the plaza, Leon Sullivan initiated the 1036 plan in 1962.
With this 1036 plan, with people contributing $10 a month for 36 months, we were able to secure enough funds to launch out on this massive endeavor.
By 1967, the 1036 plan raised over $2 million for Progress Plaza, which would house 16 Black managed businesses on Broad Street, one of the most prominent streets in Philadelphia. The Progress Plaza and the OIC are both short-term and long-term effects of the Selective Patronage campaign that still impact the community today. Progress Plaza went on to create its own Black-owned businesses under the Progress name, such as Zion Investment Associations, as well as continue to be an outlet for Black businesses in Philadelphia. Today, the OIC is an international program that continues to provide people with essential job training all over the world.
So last year, 1,500 citizens improved their lives and got specific job training from OIC. Over 3 million people have been serviced by OIC, which allowed them to get good jobs and take better care of their families.
Leon Sullivan's projects deeply impacted the issue of employment in Philadelphia, but his contributions to the civil rights movement are often untold and overlooked. What many people fail to recognize is the vast opportunities he gave African American people in the workplace and the sense of self-empowerment that he created for the Black community. Although discrimination in the workplace is a barrier that is not entirely broken, Leon Sullivan was able to dent this barrier and open up the opportunity for Black Americans to find quality jobs, receive job training, and become economically successful as a community.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
I remember the day in September 1932, I talked with an audience of farmers about the farm problem. I gave them my pledge that if I were called to serve in the White House, I would take the lead in action. Action to reverse the process of agricultural decay which had been eating at our national foundations for many years. And I have sought consistently and constantly to keep that pledge. We decided that as a nation, we would no longer promote commerce and industry at the expense of agriculture. We decided that as a nation, we would abandon the policy of rural neglect.
This neglect was rooted in the belief that rural electrification should be a private endeavor. However, the private electric utilities' pricing model and rates were too expensive and acted as a barrier to rural electrification. Not until FDR became president and created the Rural Electrification Administration did this barrier begin to crumble. FDR and REA, bringing light and power to rural America. America lagged behind in providing electricity to its farms. By 1935, several countries had rates of rural electrification ranging from 75 to 100%. In all of these countries, government aid was given to electrify farms. Meanwhile, only 10% of American farms had electricity. The private electric company's requirements for rural electrification could only be met by large-scale prosperous farmers. Farmers were required to pay for installation of power lines as well as a monthly payment to guarantee a profit to the company. These charges were in addition to wide-ranging usage rates. While families in the city had electricity to power lights, running water, washing machines, and kitchen appliances, families in the country did not have any of these modern necessities. Instead, countless hours were spent washing clothes, cleaning and filling kerosene lanterns, pumping water, chopping wood, and working the farm. On March 4, 1933, FDR became the 32nd President of the United States with the Great Depression in full swing. FDR began rolling out his New Deal to stimulate the economy through programs such as the CWA, the PWA, and the WPA. Not everyone was a fan of his alphabet soup, most notably businesses and private enterprises. The American farmers, however, knew they had an advocate for rural improvement, including electrification. FDR's first step was to establish the Tennessee Valley Authority in May 1933. The TVA was a model of a new type of federal agency that both supplied and regulated power to a very economically depressed area. With the success of the TVA, FDR had a proven model to use to electrify farms. In 1938, FDR gave a speech in Barnesville, Georgia, in which he described making this town his home 14 years prior when he was in search of a pool of warm water to help treat the crippling effects of polio. He would keep this home the rest of his days. FDR said, "There was only one discordant note in that first day when the first bill came in for electric light for my little cottage. I found that the charge was 18 cents per kilowatt hour, about four times as much as I paid in Hyde Park, New York. That started my long study of proper utility charges and the subject of getting electricity into farm homes." So it can be said that a little cottage at Warm Springs, Georgia, was the birthplace of the Rural Electrification Administration. On May 11, 1935, FDR created the REA by an executive order. This was the first step in breaking the barrier to rural electrification.
You get power at cost. When the loan from the government to your cooperative is paid back through your electric bills, you and your neighbors will own your own electric system, your own lines.
REA served as a lending agency with $100 million to be given out as loans to electrify farms. Preference was given to public bodies and nonprofit organizations, but private utilities were also eligible. At first, the private electric industry publicly supported the REA, but 6 months later, they chose not to participate. Instead, they began a rigorous opposition campaign. When farmers began forming co-ops and applying for REA loans, private utilities increased their opposition. They infiltrated towns where farmers were organizing and spread misinformation. This did not stop the farmers from forming co-ops, nor did it hamper the success of the REA. On May 20th, 1936, Congress passed a bill extending the life of the REA for 10 years, with an annual allotment of $40 million. Although FDR and the REA began to break the barrier to rural electrification, the battle was just beginning. Often fought in court as private utility companies used the legal system when their opposition campaigns were unsuccessful. Since there were not always laws that applied to electric co-ops, if state or local officials were sympathetic to private companies over the REA, court battles would ensue. In 1937, Congress passed the Rural Electrification Cooperative Act, which freed REA co-ops from state commissions, regulations, and put an end to the court battles.
Many years ago, I was told by men of experience in state and national affairs that American farmers could never agree on a program. I did not share that pessimistic belief. My friends and I went out to disprove it, and the farmers of America showed clearly that we were right. To them go the honor and the glory.
REA created a demand for equipment and appliances. They had a team of engineers to redesign transformers, conductors, meters, and worked with manufacturers to bring down costs.
So they had a vision of an electrified America, and they weren't going to let anything get in the way of stopping that. And of course, you know, as they progressed, you know, the prices came down, and, you know, the utility companies wanted, you know, $1,500, $2,000 a mile or something like that. And they were able to get it down, you know, some cases as low as, you know, in the $800, $900 range. So that was really important because, you know, again, it broke through this barrier.
From 1935 to 1940, more than a million farms were electrified, which helped to ease the burden on wives and children on the farm as their husbands went off to war.
In the midst of a world at war, we find that the foreign commerce we had managed to achieve is rudely disturbed. So it is more than ever important for farmers to have a government in Washington that is looking out for their interests, not just by uttering glittering generalities, but by specific policies and concrete actions.
REA projects contributed to the war effort as electrified farms helped to feed America and the troops. After World War II, FDR and the REA Post-War Planning Committee worked to electrify the remaining 3.5 million farms without power.
The National Farm Program is American democracy's response to agricultural distress. That farm program is a splendid example of what 6 million American families can do when they have the will and have the leadership to do it. The farmers have had a long, hard struggle to get laws and programs which give them an opportunity to obtain economic and social justice.
By the 1950s, close to 80% of rural America had light and power, and the power company's opposition to REA finally subsided. Over 1,000 rural co-ops continue to provide electricity to over 5 million customers. Unfortunately, the rural neglect FDR fought to improve can again be seen across America. Rural Americans are facing barriers to both broadband internet and healthcare.
One of the critical elements of using telemedicine is a stable broadband and internet connectivity. Do we always have that in these rural communities?
So it is kind of a patchwork around the country, and we do definitely need to spend a lot of time and resources, much like we did in the 30s and such with rural electrification.
Before the panic, was anything being done on the federal level to address the rural healthcare crisis?
We've had a lot of senators and representatives that have joined us in this fight. Unfortunately, these are systemic inequities that have been built into the system for decades, and it's really hard.
Addressing systemic inequities and rural neglect is hard, but necessary and possible. FDR provided the vision, leadership, and resources necessary to create a rural electrical infrastructure. REA served a market that the private companies had chosen to ignore by empowering rural Americans with the means to free themselves of economic and social restraints. The barriers to electric and power for rural America have been broken. Can we do the same for other rural needs, such as access to broadband and healthcare, or will the farms once again be left in the dark?
It was a man's world. Man made the cars to take us over the road, the train to carry the heavy load, the electrolyte to take us out of the dark. And it was Noah who made the ark. And it was a man, James Brown, credited for this iconic song that his girlfriend, Betty Newsom, composed during a long ride. How did 60s America turn into this man's world? What happened to Rosie the Riveter, the Wasps, Rocket Girls, and Code Girls?
They fell victim to propaganda, the polity's attempt to restore pre-war status quo. Interestingly, this direction was the diametrical opposite of the Soviet Union's course, where women enjoyed near equal status with men since the Bolshevik Revolution. In 63, when Russia sent a female, Valentina Tereshkova, into space, the Tereshkova effect inflamed the second wave of feminism in America, while it had the antipodal effect in the Soviet Union. Let's have a look.
After World War II, 7 million American veterans returned home in need of a job. A massive propaganda campaign sent women back to the home, fostering a return to normalcy. A new social order took hold as middle-class women played their part happily, hypnotized into domestic felicity.
I mean, a career is just fine, but it's no substitute for marriage. Don't you think marriage is just the most important thing in the world? I mean, a woman isn't really a woman at all until she's been married and had children. And why? Because she's fulfilled. Isn't that right?
Then, the Cold War heated up, and the space race focalized the difference between Western society and the Russian way of life. Suddenly, a series of Soviet aeronautic firsts shook America's complacency, questioning its supremacy. 7 red-blooded American men were cherry-picked to lift the morale of a nation to the moon. They had the right stuff. Moxie, manliness, something primordial. But a group of women could only watch from the sidelines. The doctor who chose the Mercury Boys, Randolph Lovelace, tested 13 women, suspecting that women would make better astronauts. When his protege, Jerry Cobb, completed the tests, the results were stunning. She outperformed the men, hands down. Girls flooded NASA with applications, but NASA categorically rejected women, citing training criteria the women couldn't match. An engineering degree, something John Glenn didn't have, and jet test piloting experience. Women, by law, were not allowed to enter the military to become jet pilots. When Jerry aced the jet test, in NASA's book, she crossed the line. All women's testing was canceled abruptly. Jerry took her case to Washington, but Lyndon Johnson directed his aide, "Let's stop this now." The Mercury women called for a congressional hearing to show discrimination. Jerry's testimony summed up the collective chagrin of the middle-class housewives of the early 60s. It's inconceivable that space would be restricted to men only, like some stag club. Let's face it, for some women, the PTA is just not enough. In disdain for the Mercury women, John Glenn blurted out, "This gets back to the way our social order is organized. It's just a fact. The men go off to fight wars and fly planes. The fact that women are not in this field is a fact of our social order." With that, the hearing adjourned. Then, on June 16, 1963, a 26-year-old amateur parachute enthusiast put on a spacesuit, strapped into a Vostok capsule, and quietly lifted into orbit, beaming with pride behind her helmet, emblazed with the letters USSR. Her name was Valentina Cherskova. A day earlier, she was an unknown Yaroslav textile worker, but she touched down a national hero, riding with Nikita Khrushchev in her own ticker tape parade, flaunting Soviet technology and equality, perfectly represented by Cherskova. Western women stood in awe, while American politicians decried the coup as cheap propaganda.
We could have put a woman up of the same type of woman and flown her instead of the chimpanzee.
Was Cherskova's flight really just propaganda? Not at all. The Soviets had a long history of women's self-actualization. The Bolshevik Revolution erased the ascriptive basis of political participation. A classless society automatically assumed the equality of gender, bringing benevolent sexism to the nascent Union, decades before the US. At first, women's liberation was a political dimension of the socialist transformation. By tearing down patriarchic family units, the central state could spread the new socialist norm. After World War II, drawing women into the labor force became an economic necessity after the Soviets suffered a 74 million population loss. This early stage did employ heavy propaganda to pull women into the workforce. By the end of the revolution, 15% of women participated in government. By the 40s, 50% comprised of the workforce. So choosing a male and a female cosmonaut seemed natural. Cherskova was an expert parachute jumper, joined the Air Force, learned to jet pilot, and quickly gained the respect of the entire cosmonaut corps. Her flight upstaged the US because it was an inconceivable feat by American social standards. The barriers she broke down were in the US, not the Soviet Union. You don't know me. Her flight had an indelible effect on American women. The landmark book that kickstarted the second wave of feminism, Betty Friedan's Feminine Mystique, got a second wind on the New York Times bestseller list after Valentina's flight. And a few months later, JFK's Presidential Commission on the Status of Women issued its scathing final report, American Women, in an effort to build on breaking barriers. Middle-class women would no longer be satisfied, relegated to homing. You don't own me. Perhaps the most interesting outcome of the Cherskova endeavor was the entirely diverging effect it had on Russian ground. 4 months after touching down, Valentina married cosmonaut Andrian Nikolaev in a wedding arranged by the Central Party, and gave birth to their daughter soon after. In his memoir, cosmonaut training director Kamenin noted, "The union was useful for politics, but presenting Cherskova as a young mother ran completely counter to the American claim of a propaganda stunt for gender equality. Why would the Central Party pressure the poster woman of égalité into marriage and motherhood? Because bringing women into the workforce to rebuild the post-war economy came with an undesirable consequence, a significant drop in birth rates, a phenomenon that would concern any economist. For the next decades, Cherskova embodied the career cosmonaut, political activist, and doting mother. The ultimate propaganda coup de grace. While raising her child, she earned the highest engineering degree, then became a member of the legislature, serving as an impeccable role model. How could she do it all? The Soviet Central Plan's greatest realization was that, in order to engage women, the state had to invest in human capital. In a novel way, childbearing was treated as a social service. Public nurseries, kindergartens, and dining halls opened up at ferocious rates. The school system was drastically expanded, since literacy was seen as a tool to successful inculcation. Women could return to work if they so chose, or stay home with pay.
there's a valuable takeaway in this story. The line between mindful central social planning and propaganda is a very fine line. We forget that the definition of propaganda is not innately negative. It can foster unity and growth, positively shaping generations like Valentina did.
To this day, she proudly wears her Hero of the Soviet Union medal, an award she very much earned and lived up to, inspiring generations of women to remember that man made the first cars to take us over the road, the first train to carry the heavy load, that first boat, spaceship, and electrolyte, but could not make the woman in either America or the Soviet Union his property right. You don't own me.
Welcome back, and please remember that you are encouraged to submit questions via that Q&A button on the right side of the Zoom screen. So I'm now joined by the filmmakers, Summer Royal from Hawaii, Sophia Alamon from Ohio, and Juliana Aleva from Pennsylvania. Welcome. Summer, I'm going to start with you. Can you tell us a little bit about the inspiration for your film? And I, you know, it's international in scope, and were you concerned at all about finding footage and images sufficient to tell your story?
Yes, of course. I'll address the first part about inspiration first. I've done National History Day projects for several years now, and one of my past projects was about the Soviet side of the space race. And when I was researching for that project, I read about Shereshkova's accomplishment. So this year when, or I should say last year, when National History Day announced that the topic would be breaking barriers in history, her flight immediately jumped into my mind. And when I went to Nationals for my space race project, I was fortunate enough to be able to visit the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum. And I saw this small 4x6 photograph that showed the cosmonaut group of the early space race. And it caught my attention because the annotation on the photograph listed the cosmonauts' names and stated that all but Shereshkova were military pilots. And there was absolutely no other trace referencing the first female cosmonaut, Shereshkova. And I felt that her accomplishment deserved a much greater recognition for breaking barriers on so many levels. And I actually originally wanted to focus my documentary on the Soviet side, but during my research, it became extremely obvious to me that her flight broke barriers not just in the Soviet Union, but also in the United States. And once I realized that she doesn't even have an authorized biography written, I wanted to dedicate my project and my documentary to memorializing her achievement. And as for the difficulty with research for this international topic, I actually felt that it was rather easy to locate footage and images despite the fact that it was not a local topic. And the reason for this is because I relied heavily on contemporary magazines like Life, Time, Look magazines, and the Ladies Home Journal. And this allowed me to get a complete picture of the times, since these were magazines that people were reading exactly in the 60s. And also advertisements and letters to the editors were extremely helpful in seeing how people reacted to this information. And it was helpful in getting myself better acclimated and understanding these times in their own context. And so my whole point was to go beyond the general public's knowledge by using these contemporary sources. And as for footage of Valentina's flight and the still images of her different life stages, it was relatively simple because her achievement was highly publicized in the Soviet Union. I could easily turn to state-issued propaganda footage to find these images.
Great. Sophia, how about you? How did you come to your topic, and how did you wind up narrowing it down to the Rural Electrification Administration?
I actually had no idea what the REA was until this year, which I think is crazy because it's such an important part of our history, and I feel like we definitely should know because it's repeating itself. So we need to like learn from our past mistakes and do better. but I always loved the New Deal in like social studies class. And like, I've always been interested in FDR. And I wanted to do something along the lines of him for this year. And I started with the fireside chats. But as I was researching for the fireside chats, I found the REA and I thought it was so interesting. And I really just wanted to tell that story. And I was so passionate about it. And that's why I didn't get sick of learning about it. And I still love learning about it now, even after my documentary is finished. So yeah, I think it's crazy that I winded up doing it on the Rural Electrification Administration, but very happy I did.
Great. And so, Juliana, you had a particular focus on local history. So what were the main resources that you used, and how did you keep all of your research organized?
Yeah, so I did a lot of research at a local archive in Philadelphia because my topic was local. There were a lot of resources that I could easily access. To keep it all organized, if I had stuff in online archives or in-person archives, I would just try and organize so that I knew what images and what videos went with what part of my documentary, because I was telling the story of Leon Sullivan and he did a lot of different things. So it was important for me to make sure my resources were organized into what accomplishment I was talking about with him.
Great. I'm, you know, really, you know, curious, back to you, Summer, for a second. We have gotten several questions in the chat. And again, I encourage people to submit their questions about the kind of resources that you're going to, specific resources to look for footage and images and things like that. So in yours in particular, I mean, I even saw that you had like, you know, wedding film in there. So I'm sort of curious where the kind of places that you were going to find the footage that you used in your documentary.
Yes. So for the American side, I was able to purchase magazines from Amazon or eBay. The same magazines that I mentioned previously, like Time and Look magazine, were especially useful in getting advertisements. And as for the Soviet side, the Soviet government, because this is a form of propaganda, in their archives, they have this footage of Chershkova's wedding and her other accomplishments like the ticker tape parade.
Okay. So, Sophia, with yours, you had some very striking images from REA posters. I'm curious about those. You used excerpts from, I don't know if those were Franklin Roosevelt fireside chats or State of the Union addresses or whatever, but I'm curious where you got that audio. And then how did you decide where to put them in the film? Had you kind of created a outline or an editing decision list, or, you know, exactly how did you decide to put that together?
I think the two places I got like the coolest resources were the State Library of Ohio. I found a lot of articles and graphs and like pamphlets and stuff in the Federal Repository, I think it is. And those are really awesome. I used a lot of those in the beginning of my documentary just to like lay like the groundwork of what my project was about and like the information behind all of it. And then I went into more of pictures of farms and families who now had electricity. Other than the State Library, my probably number one is the Library of Congress, the website. That's where I found those posters. They're Beale posters, very vibrant. And I felt like it brought like the whole energy of the documentary up a little bit because a lot of my other images are kind of somber. So I really loved using those. So yeah, if there's any students that are thinking about making a documentary, like from kind of, cause it was in the 1930s. So that isn't as like present as some of the other ones, then I would say definitely go to the Library of Congress website because they have the best everything, all the best resources, and then local libraries too.
Thank you very much for the Library of Congress shout out. Juliana, you're, again, with your local focus, I'm kind of curious the kind of resources that you use that, you know, might
spur a student watching us now who's thinking about local history to think about the kind of resources in their community that they might be looking for. So, you know, where did you go for your research? And you also had interviews in there as well. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. As for resources, I definitely used local archives a lot. It's crazy the amount of information that you can find at an archive, especially when your topic is local. There's like piles and piles of stuff to go through. And as for interviews, I was able to contact people because if they were very close to me and it was easy to get in touch with people. And then they, from there, got me in touch with other people. And it was a really great experience to be able to build kind of a community based off my topic. And I got to hear great stories from people who impacted the history of my own city. And so if you are thinking about doing a local topic, using the people in your community and the resources in your community is a great way to do that.
Fantastic. Summer, I'm curious, what software did you use to create your film? We've gotten several questions about editing software. And in particular, your film, it's full of music and some very interesting graphics, like those nesting dolls that you put in the corner. So I'm curious, why did you make those creative choices?
As for the software, I use Sony Vegas Movie Studio. And at the time that I first got it, Sony owned it, and it was a free trial version that I was able to download. However, over the years, the program was sold several times, so now it's actually not available as a free trial. But even today, if somebody were to purchase it today, I believe it's only $45 for the licensed program, which pales in comparison to other movie editing programs that could cost in the hundreds. And as for my graphics, for the nesting doll, what I did is I got a blank Matryoshka doll set, and I painted them myself and put a screw in the back so that I could use pliers to pick it up and move it. And I painted the pliers green, and I used a green screen, or I should say I painted my wall green. And then I put up a shelf so that I could stand below the shelf so that I wouldn't be in the shot. And I just picked up the heads and moved them across. And because I had a green background and the pliers were green, I was able to edit out the background and add that as a new layer on Sony Movie Studios. And that's one of the great features about this movie editing software, that you can have many, many, many layers. And that's exactly how I did my animations, that I just added new layers. And I think by the end, with everything cooked down and boiled down, it was about 20 layers that I had. So with my animations, what I do is, say, for example, the flipping of photos, I can have that as one video and overlay that on top of the background information that I'm presenting and use a transition to that specific layer that doesn't affect the other layers in the background.
Great. Sophia, did you have a background in video editing at all when you came into this? And I'm also curious how your film evolved through the competition process.
Well, my answer to this question is a lot different than Summer's probably, because I just used iMovie on my mom's old 2011 MacBook, and I used a microphone that I think was probably for Guitar Hero or something, and I don't know, I just like did the best I could, and I made it work, and obviously it worked out pretty well. But if anybody's watching and like are intimidated by like big words, like, because I am too, because I don't really know. I don't have a fancy editing software, but no, you can definitely do it like with whatever you have, because I've never done anything like technical before. And I really just loved my topic so much and really wanted to do a documentary. So I just did the best I could, but I will be upgrading from iMovie for my next documentaries. But my documentary that I turned in May for the national competition was a lot different from the one that I submitted for regionals. There's like, I didn't even tie it back to rural broadband and healthcare in the beginning, I found that like throughout the process, and that's one of my favorite parts about my documentary. So it's never finished. I don't even think it's finished now, and it's already turned in, but you could always do more.
Well, that I think that feedback that you get seems to be very important. That's certainly a theme that I've heard again and again from you filmmakers. Juliana, can you talk a little bit about the importance of feedback that you received in improving your documentary?
Yeah, I got a lot of feedback. My history teacher, my amazing history teacher, Miss Taylor, she helped me so much with feedback and gave me the exact second of something that she wanted to tell me. I showed it to my history class, which was really scary, but it was super helpful because they all gave me feedback. Showing it to friends and family. I showed it to people who I interviewed to, you know, see how what they thought about it. Feedback is so important because when you work on something for a long time, it's kind of hard to see certain things that other people would probably pick up on. And also being able to like take feedback and then transform it in your own way and use that feedback and creatively like change your documentary is something really cool, and feedback is super important, really helpful.
We have a question in the chat, which I think might have arisen from actually viewing all three of your films. Why do you think people should know and care about your topic? Why should it matter in the 21st century? And all of you, I think, did a really, really good job of sort of tying your films to things that are going on today. So Summer, would you start?
Yes. I think that there is a strong connection with my topic to the present, where in the post-World War II era, women were not employed in a long list of professions. And during my research, I found out that the former Supreme Court Justice Sandra Day O'Connor graduated from Stanford Law School and was the editor of a very prestigious Stanford Law Review. Yet upon graduating, she sent her resume to all the major law firms and nobody would hire her simply because she was a woman. And eventually someone offered her a secretarial job, and she had to prove herself for quite some time before she could even practice law, despite graduating at the top of her class at a very prestigious law school. And today this experience is unimaginable. But with that said, even today, women still only earn about 70 cents for every man's dollar. So I think that it's these stories from our past that allow us to reflect on the changes we've made in the past and how we can move forward with very similar problems that we still face today. And of course, we've made major milestones and movements in changing some of the injustices that we've faced in the past. But I think that this particular topic is one example of an issue that we still see little speckles of here and today in society. And so I think it's important to learn about the past issues of this topic.
Sophia, how about you?
Well, I truly believe that history repeats itself, not even with my documentary with rural broadband in healthcare, but with the penicillin in the junior category too. And it's really important to bring light to these topics that maybe haven't been brought up in so long, and because they can teach us new things that we can learn from. And I think it's really, really important because I never would have known anything about rural broadband and healthcare if I didn't do this documentary and find this topic. And I'm very thankful I was given this sort of outlet to like show people that history does repeat itself and we really need to learn from that. And it's not even just like rural broadband, it's like you can tell like everything that's going on in the world, we really just need to come together and realize that if we've made this change before, we can definitely do it again.
Thanks. Juliana, has your documentary changed you? Has it made you feel more a part of your community?
Yes, definitely. There's a lot of civil rights history in Philadelphia that I still don't know about, and I didn't know about a lot before I did my documentary. even just like going by certain places in Philadelphia, Progress Plaza is a place that I passed by so many times, and I had no idea the historical significance of that place. And being able to talk to people who experienced these events firsthand really just, I don't know, opened my eyes and made me appreciate the struggles that other people go through, and made me look at the ways that Leon Sullivan tried to, you know, break barriers and how we can replicate his motives and try and break down the barriers that we still have today.
I asked this of the juniors as well. So you guys finished your documentaries during a global pandemic. Do you have tips for some students who are watching us that have to, they're facing those very same challenges now? Summer?
Well, I think for me, my answer will probably differ a little bit from the others because I did not choose a local topic. So as far as my research goes, it didn't affect me too much that I was doing this in the pandemic, since most of my resources I either had to buy on Amazon or research online, since I wasn't going to any local archives or any local areas of research. And I think someone in the junior division mentioned that it's important to reach out to those who you need help from. So for me, what I do, because I'm isolated from my resources, for example, in the past, I've contacted Krishtov. And I think that my biggest advice for students watching this would be that if you feel that you don't have the resources where you are, don't be afraid to reach out and ask for help. All the time, curators are more than happy to bend over backwards, looking something up in their museum and sending it back to me, because people want to help students who are trying to educate themselves and gain an understanding about the exact topic that they are researching themselves. And so I think that, I guess my advice would just be to reach out to others and to look for resources online that would be available even in a pandemic.
I can certainly second that as somebody who is occasionally used as a resource for documentaries like this. The problem with asking a subject matter expert like me is getting us to shut up. So I think that that's extremely good advice. Sophia, any advice that you have for folks working in a pandemic?
I think the most important thing to understand is that communication really is the key to understanding, which is the theme for next year's History Day project. And I think we've learned that through all of this too, like Zoom interviews, and I'm sure we wouldn't have been able to communicate as much, like I guess as openly as we have, because we've had so many Zooms and we've watched all these documentaries, and I've been able to come in contact with so many amazing people through Zoom. And I interviewed Jeffrey Urban from the FDR Library, and maybe that wouldn't have happened if I wasn't emailing with him like back and forth and had the ability to do it on Zoom. So I think it's really important to remember that as hard as these times can be, like maybe there are benefits, because I think this, what we're doing right now with the Zoom and everything, is pretty amazing. So
as we get near the end of our conversation, I'll just ask a really simple question. I'll start with you, Juliana. Was it fun?
Yeah, it was. It's definitely a lot of work. Not going to sugarcoat that. But when you get a topic that you're really passionate about and really interested in learning about that makes an impact on you, you actually want to keep going and keep learning. And it was really rewarding for me to learn how to figure out my own creativity in a documentary and meet a lot of great people. So it was a lot of fun.
Fantastic. Summer, how about you?
Yes, of course. It was definitely a lot of fun. And I just want to echo her in saying that I think it's really important that you choose a topic that means a lot to you, because I think for everyone here, this topic has somewhat grown a part of our lives. Like it's exactly what we want to tell people about. And so I think that when you're doing something that feels like it's a part of you, you never want to stop researching and talking about it and learning more about this topic. And so, of course, if I was given a different topic about something in ancient Greece or something that I didn't have as much interest in, then no, it wouldn't have been fun. But because I love my topic and I love everything about my documentary and I never want to stop working on it, it was fun for me.
Sophia, how about you?
Yes, this is amazing. And I've said that so many times, but I'm so thankful that I have this opportunity to meet so many amazing people. I couldn't imagine like speaking to Ken Burns, but it's all crazy. And it's so fun. I'm so thankful.
Fantastic. Well, it's very inspiring, and I've really enjoyed talking to all of you. Summer, Sophia, and Juliana, thank you so much for spending time with us today and giving us your insights, and really congratulations on your achievement. So to close out the program, I'd like to introduce Dr. Kathy Gorn, who's the Executive Director of National History Day, for some final remarks. Over to you, Dr. Gorn.
Thanks, Mike. And once again, congratulations to our NHG 2020 individual documentary winners. And thanks so much to you, Mike, for moderating this great discussion. And thanks especially for you guys for teaching me so much. I learned so much from watching your films. And by the way, Allison, my sister was an incubator baby. So thanks for telling me more about that. As Mike noted, I'm Kathy Gorn, and I'm Executive Director of National History Day. And I want to say thank you to everyone who joined us today, to all the teachers who invited this film festival into your classroom. And I want to say especially thank you to all of the students out there for joining us and hopefully becoming as inspired as I have been by watching these wonderful, wonderful documentaries. You know, as I listened to the thoughtful questions that you all sent in and the really wonderful and fascinating answers, I have to admit I got a little choked up. And that's because I have hope. You really give me hope. You understand, you get it. You know that studying the past is really important to understand the present. And to be prepared to be really thoughtful and engaged citizens of our democracy. So I'm just so proud of you. I want to say a huge, huge thank you to National History Day students, every National History Day student's hero, Ken Burns. Thank you so much, Ken, for involving us in this very special event. And super thank you to the entire team of the Better Angels Society for helping us celebrate our students' work and also for putting on this wonderful virtual event. And so on behalf of not just myself and my board, but and my colleagues here at History Day office, but the entire History Day network, thanks so much for your support and for celebrating and honoring these wonderful students. Really looking forward to continuing our working relationship as we move forward into the next year. And speaking of that, as we just heard, the theme for 2021 National History Day is communication in history, the key to understanding. So all you students out there, if you have become inspired to perhaps do some research and create a documentary, or maybe you just want to get into some historical topic and choose one of our other category types of projects, you can do that. It's only the beginning right now, so go to nhd.org, to our website, and you'll find all kinds of resources and information to help you get started. Teachers, don't forget, you'll find lots of wonderful things for the classroom there at our website as well. So, on behalf of National History Day, once again, thank you, students, for your inspiration. And thank you, Ken and the Better Angels Society, for this really wonderful presentation. Have a great day.